Hello students, in this video we deal with the design procedure for spur gauge. We will go through the steps involved in designing a spur gear for a given application. Please note that you will need your data and book as we go through this video, so please have it with you. And when I go through the design procedure step by step, you may not exactly, some of you may find it difficult to follow. Don't worry, when we go on and start solving the problem, you will understand it better. This is only an overview of the design procedure. Okay, so moving on. A gear is designed such that its teeth will not break under the load while it is transmitting power, and at the same time its surface will not damage. So gear teeth are designed for strength as well as surface wear. One of the fundamental equations in the design of gears is what is termed as Lewis equation. Lewis equation analyzes for the stresses induced in a gear tooth when it is engaged with a beating gear. So before we go ahead and discuss the design procedure, I thought it is necessary that we study Lewis equation. That is, we will go through its derivation and try to understand what it gives out. Now, if you refer to the figure that is given here, in deriving Lewis equation, a gear tooth which engages with a mating gear is taken as a cantilever beam. You see that at one end you will have the tangential force which provides the torque for the driver gear to drive the driven gear. Therefore, PT is the tangential force that acts. What you see here, the rectangular section is the root section. Now, the tangential forces induce a bending moment about the base of the tooth, about the root. And we can see from the figure that the bending moment will be PT into perpendicular distance H. Okay, now in deriving Lewis equations, there are four assumptions that we make, which are important. First one, we know that spur gear tooth are also subjected to radial forces, which we have seen in the previous presentation. Now, radial component, which actually induces a certain amount of compressive stress, is neglected in the analysis. That is one of the important assumptions that we make. The focus will be on the bending stresses induced, because it is the bending stress that causes gear tooth failure. The second assumption is that the tangential component, the tangential force that is shown in the figure, is uniformly distributed over the face, as you see in this figure. Third one is the effect of stress eraser, or the stress concentration, is neglected here. And fourth one is, this is a very important assumption, at any given point in time during the operation of the gear, we assume that only one pair of teeth is in action. That is, only one tooth of both pinion and gear are in mesh. This need not be true in all cases. In gears, we can see two or more pairs of teeth in which are like engaging simultaneously. But for deriving the Lewis equation, we assume that it is only one pair of teeth which are in mesh at any given point in time during operation. Okay, So going on with the derivation of the Lewis equation, focus on figure 17.40 here. In this figure, we assume the profile to be a parabola. Now this is again a assumption, that is, we will construct a parabola as shown in this dotted line here. The reason why we do this is because a parabolic outline will have uniform strength across all cross sections. So in the figure we can see that the weakest section will be at the base, will be at the section denoted as XX. The reason being, this is the section at which the bending moment will be maximum. Okay, so that is an assumption. This parabolic profile is an assumption to because the reason why we make this parabolic profile assumption is because in the existing involute profile, the stresses constantly vary from the base to the tip, which makes it difficult for us to analyze for stresses. Whereas when we have a parabolic profile assumption, it becomes simpler. Now, with this figure, we can see that the bending moment induced at section XX will be the tangential component multiplied by H. Therefore, PT into H, transverse force into the depth H, gives you the bending moment. Now, since the root is considered to be of a rectangular section, the moment of inertia will be BTQ by 12. And the distance of the farthest fiber from the neutral axis, NA, we know is T by 2. Thickness of the tooth by 2. Now, the reason why we need M by M, B, I and Y is naturally to obtain the bending stress, which we will see in the next slide. Okay, so we begin with the bending stress. At the left top corner, you can see that the bending stress, which we know is M by I into Y, if you substitute bending moment as PT into H and Y as T by 2 and moment of inertia as BTQ by 12, you can rearrange this and you will get this formula. PT transverse force is equal to B into bending stress into T square by 6H. Now, to generalize this, we multiply and divide the terms on the RHS by module. That is, we multiply and divide by M. Now, the term that we get within the bracket, T square by 6HM, is denoted as capital letter Y, which is an important factor known as the Lewis form factor. Now, you can rewrite the above formula to obtain PT equal to MBCB into Y. I call this equation A. And this equation leads to the Lewis equation, which we will see in the next slide. Okay, so we have obtained equation PT equal to MB sigma B into Y. Now, if you will observe this equation, the module and B and the profile form factor MB and Y remains fixed. Therefore, what it means is the tangential force and stress are proportional, meaning when the tangential force increases, the stress will also increase. When the force increases to a magnitude at which we reach maximum possible stress or maximum permissible stress, then the value of PT is termed as beam strength. Okay, or in other words, beam strength is the maximum value of tangential force that induces maximum stress without failure. Okay? And that maximum beam strength is denoted as S suffix B. Therefore, in the above equation, replacing PT by SB, which is beam strength, we get the Lewis equation as ST equal to MB sigma B into Y, where ST is beam strength, sigma B is maximum permissible bending stress, Y is Lewis form factor. This equation is what is known as Lewis equation, which we use to check for the stresses induced in a gear tooth. Okay, speaking a bit more about the Lewis equation, ST equal to MB sigma B into Y. In order to avoid breakage of the gear tooth, that is to as long as you don't want the gear tooth to fail under the load during the power transmission, the beam strength ST should be more than the effective force between the meshing teeth. Okay. And this effective force is obtained, you can derive it as the tangential force multiplied by two refining factors, CS and CV. CS is known as service factor. Service factor is a correction factor that we use based on the operating nature of the gear, which includes how many hours of like operation, what is the severity of like operation, and so on. The value of CS for a given application you will get from your handbook. Similarly, CV is known as velocity factor, which again can be calculated using Barth equation, which is available in your handbook. So effective force is a modified version of the tangential force. And for the gear tooth to not fail, the beam strength should be greater than the effective force. Okay, now to design gears, one of the most important steps is we need to identify which is the weaker gear. Is it the pinion or the gear? And we will only design for the weaker gear. Because when we design for the weaker gear, naturally the meshing gear will also be safe. Now, how do we decide which is the weaker gear? The deciding factor is the product of stress into form factor. If you will see the Lewis equation, assuming M and B to be same for both gear and the pinion, we will see that the deciding factor therefore will be sigma B into Y. And whichever is lower, the product sigma B into Y is lower for pinion, then pinion will be the weaker gear. If sigma B into Y is lower for the gear, then gear will be weaker. Now, it is generally found that the Lewis form factor is always smaller for pinion as compared with the gear. Therefore, when the material used for pinion and gear is same, pinion is usually weaker than the gear. Therefore, we generally design for pinion. Alright, so with that information regarding Lewis equation and bending stress induced in a gear, we will go ahead and rush through the design procedure for spur gears. Please note that I have taken it directly from my class notes, and I'm pretty sure many of you may not be able to appreciate the significance of every step when I go through the procedure now, but it will become much more clearer when you solve the problem. Okay, so I will just go step by step and discuss what is the procedure in designing a spur gear. The first step, as you see here, is identifying the gear ratio. Gear ratio is denoted by I, and it is nothing but the ratio of speeds, number of teeth and diameters. Okay. This you would have already learned in your kinematics of machines subject. N1 will be for pinion, N2 will be for the gear. Z2 is for the gear and Z1 is for the pinion. D2 is for the gear and D1 is for the pinion. The ratio gives you the gear ratio value I. That is, now this is what you begin with. Then, moving on in step 1, if Z1 is known, if number of teeth in the pinion is known, then we can go ahead and solve the problem. If not, assume Z1. There is a table 12.4 in our handbook which gives you approximate number of Z1 based on the pressure angle. Pressure angle will normally be specified in terms of the standard tooth profile, 14.5 degree or 20 degrees. Once you find out IZ1, then you go ahead and check. If the center distance between the two shafts is given, then you will have two formulas, A equal to D1 plus D2 by 2, which is the center distance, and you will have D2, which is equal to I into D1, which is from the gear ratio formula. So from the two formulas, you will calculate D1, D2, Z1 and Z2. Therefore, diameters and number of teeth can be found out. Then going on, we will make use of the Levy's form factor, which is given in equation 12.5 C, D and E. It will be an equation like this. This is your Levy's formula, which is available in your handbook. And then based on this, if one of the material of the pinion or the gear is known, then the other suitable material can be identified from table 12.7 based on the fact that sigma d into y for pinion is equal to sigma d 2 into y 2, which is for the gear. Okay. Now suppose if no material is specified, then assume that the pinion is made up of nickel chromium. Okay, so that was step 1. Then moving on to step 2, as we discussed before, we always design for the weaker member. Now we need to identify which is the weaker member among pinion and gear. So you see, we have values for permissible stresses and Levy's form factor and its product here. Now for find out the value for both pinion and for a gear, and smaller among this will be the weaker gear. Okay, and once you identify the weaker gear, then we will find out all design parameters with reference to the weaker gear. In step 3, we begin with tangential tooth load given in formula 12.7a. This is the tangential force. It is dependent upon the power and the velocity factor V. Okay. So we will go ahead and find out the tangential force value. Now, the second step is tangential tooth load by Levy's equation. You have one tangential load equation which you have already found out, and then by making use of the Levy's equation, you will get the second formula here, Ft equal to sigma d sigma v Cv By into P, which is your Levy's equation. Now here, the width of the tooth is taken as per equation 12.5f. And if it is not given, you can assume the width to be 10 mm. Y is the form factor which you have already determined in step 1. P is the circular pitch, and for circular pitch we know it is pi into module. And And CV is the velocity factor which you will obtain from equations 12.6C to 12.6E from our handbook. Okay, now from these two equations, you will determine the module M using a trial and error method. Okay, now this we will say begin with module equal to 3, obtain a velocity factor, and then obtain a velocity of the gear, and then find out the velocity factor and check it with CV M cube value. Now, if the obtained value is lower than CV M cube, then we can select M is equal to 3, or else we move on to the next trial 2 and then trial 3 and so on until we arrive at a value of module which is lower than CV M cube value. Okay, now if the design problem is for asked for only 10 marks, then we stop here. Once you find the value of module M, we can use table 12.4 and obtain the design parameters and stop it there. But if it is asked for more marks, then you will have to check for the stresses too. Now, in checking for the stress, initially we will find out allowable stress, then you calculate induced stress based upon the tangential force value which you have already calculated in step 2, and then check both. Now, if induced stress is less than allowable stress, then the design is safe. If not, you will have to increase the value of a module and repeat the process. Okay, then check for beam strength, that is effective force is tangential force by CB, right? And the ratio of the tangential force to effective force, the bending force to effective force is your factor of safety. Now, bending force you will get from the Lewis equation. Now, if the factor of safety is greater than 1, then the design is safe. Now, after you have checked for stresses, then we go on to the dynamic load. We know that in Lewis equation, we assume that the load is static, whereas in real life, the gear tooth or the force FD will not be static, it will be varying. Now, the dynamic load equation FD is given in equation 12.12. Now, substitute all the factors and you will get the value of FD. The value of the dynamic load is used to check for the wear load. Gear tooth wear is obtained or is studied using equation 12.15. Wear load equal to D1BQK. Now, if K, the constant K is unknown, then we will equate D1BQK with FD because it is the dynamic load that induces wear. And for safe design, the dynamic load should be smaller than the wear load. Now, what we can do is from table 12.16 we find K for for given K and the pressure angle, from table or from equation 12.15b, we find out the Brinell hardness number. Now, why is hardness needed here? Because higher the hardness, lower will be the wear. Now, we can use this formula here. If using 12.15b, we can find out sigma ES. And from table 1.1, we will find out the BHN value. Okay, now this is the last step. Once you find out the Brinell hardness number, we will stop the design process. And because we can check if FD is less than FD. W. Now, after this, all you have to do is we will go to table 12.4a, and for the module which we have identified in the previous step, all gear parameters will be calculated. This is table 12.4 that we get from your handbook, and you can see that all gear tooth parameters such as pressure angle, addendum, minimum dedendum, minimum total depth, clearance, thickness, backlash, outside diameter and approximate fillet radius. All these parameters are expressed in terms of module M, which you can calculate now depending upon the pressure angle value. So this is the rough procedure of designing a spur gear. What we will do is we will take up a problem and solve it using these steps that I have specified here, and you will learn the design process better.